This is a copy of the first ever intelligence test. The questions contained in here were developed and presented in 1908, but this is a 1911 English translation and guide to the test. It aims to find the mental age of a subject, and so there are several questions for each age, ranging from 1 to 13. This test was developed by Alfred Binet and Theodore Simon. It's called the Binet-Simon scale, and whilst this scale does not talk about IQ, it is this work that would ultimately be hijacked, changed, and lead to the long and dark story of IQ tests, so I think we should take a look at it. For age 1, the experimenter is told to move a lighted match slowly before the subject's eyes, or ring a bell from behind the subject. They pass if their eyes follow it or if they listen. For age 2, hold before subject or place within subject's reach a piece each of candy or cookie and wood of equal size. They pass if the candy is chosen. For age 3, ask them to repeat a sentence word by word, such as, "My dog's name is Fido." For age 4, ask which of these two lines is the longer. If there's hesitation, then they fail. For age 5, here are a couple of boxes which look alike, don't they? But they don't weigh the same. One is heavier than the other. Now I want you to lift one after the other this way and give me the one which feels the heavier. Now for age 6, there's a pretty wild question. It says, show the pretty and ugly faces in pairs. Ask which of these two faces is the prettier or uglier? Or which is the good-looking one? This seems like one of the more absurd questions. They don't give the answers for it, and I suppose that's because they think it's obvious to the examiner. I can probably guess what you're supposed to pick, but it seems pretty dubious. I mean, they've drawn this one a lot larger than the other one. Is that to say that they think it's uglier? All three must be correct. If they say that both are pretty, then they fail. This is a question for age 7. The question is, what is lacking or missing in each of these pictures? As strange as they are, these kinds of questions and this kind of mental age gives you a clue as to what this test was developed for. It was intended to identify abnormally low mental development in French school children. There was an important reason that Binet and Simon wanted to make a test. Compulsory primary school education had just been introduced in France, and a psychiatrist by the name of Bourneville argued that children who had difficulty understanding schoolwork had become a problem. In previous times, they would have just not attended school. Bourneville wanted to send such students to boarding houses attached to psychiatric institutions so that they didn't burden mainstream schools. Decisions over who would be sent to the psychiatric institutions would be made by a psychiatrist. Binet and Simon opposed this. Binet was part of his own lobby group to convince politicians to seek alternative solutions. As part of a commission into the issue, he was motivated to come up with a better form of assessment of children's mental development. Here's the test questions for age 8. I want you to read this story aloud. Three houses burned. New York, September 5th. A fire last night burned three houses in Water Street. It took some time to put it out. The loss was $50,000 and 17 families lost their homes. In saving a girl who was asleep in a bed, a fireman was burned on the hands. A couple seconds later, the examiner is to ask, "Now tell me what you read about. What did it say?" The subject passes if they can recall two distinct memories from the passage. For age 9, what date is it today? This is a question I'm not sure I could pass too easily. I think these ones are really interesting for mental age 10. What should you do, or what ought you to do, when you miss a train? When a friend hits you without meaning to? For the train one, you pass if you say, wait for the next or take another, and you fail if you say, hurry, go to the next station or walk. For the friend hitting you, you pass if you forgive, excuse, don't be angry or don't cry. If you don't tell his mother and say nothing, you also pass. But you fail if you hit him, cry, tell a mother or a grown-up, get angry or avoid him. For age 11, I'm going to read you some sentences in which there is something silly. Listen carefully and try to tell me what the nonsense is. 1. Yesterday there was an accident on the railroad, but it wasn't very serious. There were only 48 killed. 2. The police found yesterday the body of a young girl cut into 18 pieces. They think that she killed herself. There's apparently something absurd in the sentence, Johnny bought a little rubber ball, he paid $1 for it. Doesn't sound absurd to us, but I think back in 1908 when this was written, a ball should have cost much less than $1. Especially because there are other questions in this test talking about buying things for a mere 2 or 3 cents. For age 12, you're asked to repeat a series of 7 digits, such as 2, 9, 6, 4, 3, 7, 5. And to figure out what's going on in these situations. One is, a girl who was walking in the woods in a park saw something hanging from the branch of a tree that made her so much afraid that she ran to the nearest policeman and told him what she had seen. What do you think she saw? What was it? You'd pass if you say, a body. The hardest questions in this test belong to mental age 13. For this question, a piece of paper is folded twice, so it's in quarters, and then a corner and some bits of the side are cut off. The subject is asked to draw what the paper will look like once it's unfolded. And the last question on the test here asks the subject to explain what is the difference between evolution and revolution, or between poverty and misery, event and advent, pride and pretension. In the end, the examinee should be credited with the mental age in which all of the tests, or all but one, are passed. So if someone could answer all of the age 10 questions except one, but they couldn't answer, say, all of the age 11 questions, then they'd be marked as having the mental age of 10. Although they can be credited with one extra year for every 5 tests passed at higher levels. So maybe they got some of the 11, 12, or 13 year questions. In 1909, the year after this test was published, Binet's lobby group was successful in stopping children being sent to psychiatric hospitals, and instead a law was passed that led to the establishment of special classes for slow children attached to public schools. I have here a book which compiles other work from Binet and Simon from 1903 to 1911. It includes work that went into developing the test I just showed you. This book has been translated into English and includes a few results of some tests that were given to students. A 7-year-old boy named Maud failed the prettiness test. It says he did not indicate the correct figures. But he also did poorly on the unfinished pictures task. He was silent about the 1st and 4th figures, and for the 2nd and 3rd, he said that the neck was missing. From these and many other questions, it was concluded that Maud was 2 years behind his age. You've seen that the questions only go up to a mental age of 13, and here Binet and Simon say that the test is designed only for children of school age. They say that a pupil who passes all the tests for the 13th year may have a mental capacity superior to that age, but how much? Our tests do not show us. The notes in the margin of this book were made by Lewis Terman. I'll get to him later. In the instructions for the examiner, they say he must not allow himself to be influenced by information regarding the child obtained from other sources. He must say to himself that nothing which he already knows about the child counts at all. He must consider the child as an X to be solved by this means alone. Binet and Simon hoped that this would allow their test to be fairer and more objective than the other tests, where a psychiatrist, perhaps in consultation with the teacher, would make a decision on their own as to whether they thought the child should be taken to an institution. But they also say, in the most emphatic manner, our test of intelligence will not suffice to know absolutely that a child is subnormal. They talk about the case of an 11-year-old girl named Germaine. Her parents tried to enroll her in a school, but she was rejected. She was hesitant in her reading and could barely write a sentence. She was said to be 3 years behind, but she made an impression on Binet and Simon. They said she was wide awake and mischievous, with a vivacity of speech. They performed their Binet-Simon scale test on her, and it found that she was only a year behind, rather than the three they had been told. They call it a characteristic example, which shows the use of our measuring scale. They took their test to a psychiatric hospital and examined 25 children, where they found that three of them were in fact at age in intelligence, and two others were a year advanced beyond the average. They say that nothing could show more clearly that, with the means which it has at its command, the mental clinic is not in a position to diagnose correctly a child's intelligence. And then there's a stab at Bourneville. They say, we've cited this fact for the benefit of Royer, intern of Bourneville, who took upon himself to inveigh against our last book. They are letting us know that Bourneville has been making disapproving and hostile comments towards their test. Binet and Simon say that a two-year lag between the mental age and the chronological age indicates abnormal development, and they are in favour of intervening with special attention and a modified program to help them catch up. They recommend starting with remedial teaching. They think that only the most severe cases should be sent to a special class. Now, this book, English Translations of Binet and Simon's Work, was edited together by a man named Henry Goddard. Here is his handwriting as he's gifting the book to his friend Terman. Goddard is one of the people who took this test and ran with it to dark places. He published his own version of the Binet-Simon test and used it for immigration and to support his beliefs in eugenics. He pushed for forced sterilization of people he called feeble-minded, and in the US, this happened to over 60,000 people. It was another man, William Stern, who in 1912, after a conversation with Goddard, came up with the calculation that would become known as IQ. He took the Binet-Simon scale and divided the mental age by the chronological age, and then multiplied it by 100. So if a 10-year-old has a mental age of 8, then 8 out of 10 times 100 is an IQ of 80. In this way, 100 is always the average IQ, and a child 10 years old who has a mental age of 12 would score 120. Lewis Terman, who made the notes in the margins, was a psychologist at Stanford, and in 1937 he adapted and renamed the test to the Stanford-Binet Intelligence Scale, seemingly forgetting Simon's contributions altogether. But by this time, Simon was already angry at the use of the test, calling it a betrayal to use it for any purpose other than helping children with problems. Binet died in 1911, not long after he wrote the last pages in this book, so he didn't get to see what intelligence testing would morph into. Nowadays, some people think you can identify genius in adults using such a test. I don't think we should place too much weight on that. People should instead brag about their contributions to the world, things they've made or achieved, people they've helped, and not their test scores. A high score on any test, let alone an IQ test, is not a good enough reason to trust someone or to treat them as superior. I hope that taking a look at where this test started has provided some useful context. If you enjoyed this video and want to see me make more, then please consider supporting this channel on Patreon. For silver patrons, I am mailing out a pack of stickers plus these ribbons of support, which you could use as a bookmark the next time you are reading about historical IQ tests. Thanks for watching, and a special shout out to today's suspicious looking patron cat of the day, Tibees.